The Retirement Cafe Podcast, episode 75, How to Write the Story of Your Life.
Retired or thinking about retirement? You've come to the right place. Welcome to the Retirement Cafe Podcast. In each episode, we bring you an important conversation with insight, tips and knowledge, all designed to help you live a fulfilling and successful life in retirement. Here's your host, chartered financial planner and accredited later life advisor, Justin King.
Hello and welcome to the latest episode of the Retirement Cafe Podcast, which is brought to you by the Timeline app. Timeline is retirement income planning software that helps financial planners like me bring your retirement journey to life and answer your big retirement income questions. Today's guest was recommended to me by Esther Ranson, who you may have heard on the podcast back in February. She joined me to chat about the amazing work the Silver Line is doing to tackle loneliness and isolation in later life. If you missed that episode, head to our website, theretirementcafe.co.uk, and search for episode 68. So today I'm delighted to share with you my conversation with Bryher Scudamore. With a background in newspapers and TV editing, Bryher found herself launching her first business at the age of 60, following her mother's sudden and unexpected death. As she was going through her mother's papers, Bryher discovered how much she didn't know about her mother's earlier life that she wished she'd asked her about while she was still alive. So Bryher founded autodotbiography, an easy way for you to create a beautiful account of your life story for generations to come. Here's my conversation with Bryher. So welcome to Bryher Scudamore, who's here to chat to the Retirement Cafe this morning all about autodotbiography. Welcome, Bryher.
Hello, how do you do?
Very well, thank you. Lovely to meet you. I know you're a great friend of Esther Ranson, who I had a lovely chat with the other week about Silverline and the great work that she's doing. And she was very excited to tell me about the great work that you're doing.
Thank you. We are very good friends, and she's a great supporter. And yeah. I'm a great supporter of hers and the Silver Line. It's a great organisation.
Absolutely. So, Bryher, you've got a bit of a personal story. I mean, one of the really interesting things, I think, for our listeners is you've started a business at the age of 60. And we often think that, you know, starting businesses is for 20s and 30-somethings, you know. So tell me about your business.
Well, I started my business, which is called, as you said quite rightly, autodotbiography, because I was inspired by the untimely and unexpected death of my beloved mother, Peggy. Wonderful, wonderful woman. Wow. And when she died, I realised there were so many things about her life that I just didn't know. And obviously, it was too late to ask her. And having had been a journalist for 40 years and talked to people about their stories and told their stories, I thought I would become a ghostwriter. And I love talking to people and love hearing so. But then I worked out it was going to cost an absolute fortune for people to pay for. So, and I'm a broadcaster. I like everybody to be involved. And so I then created an online system that means that anybody, no matter how good or bad at writing they are, can create a beautiful hardback book of their life story for their family. And it looks a bit like this is a kind of sample book. So, and it has all the pictures. And all the pictures, that's me, 18 months old.
Oh, wow.
Anyway, so, but it was my mother's death because we would go to shows, we would be talking about politics and coronavirus and whatever else is going on. But we lived in the present, and so many people do the same thing. And then I hear people say to me all the time, oh, if only I'd written down what my mum said, or if only I'd written down what my dad said. So that's what inspired me to create the business. And I don't think about age. The truth is, and I'm sure it's true of your listeners and viewers, is I think I'm 27. Now, it's only when I look in the mirror that I get a very nasty shock. But until I look in the mirror, I'm 27. So, you know, I started the business actually at 27, although I'm now 69. Yeah.
Right. Well, you look great on it. Tell me, what was it, you know, what was the kind of the tipping point or the point that, you know, you got to, you know, so you mentioned a second ago the untimely death of your mother and the shock of that. And then tell me, how did it really happen? I mean, how did you go from your mother's death to starting your autobiography?
Well, as I said, I thought I'd be a ghostwriter and realised that wasn't going to work financially because most people would cost know, anything between 12, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40,000 pounds to have a ghostwriter for an individual to interview them and then write, etc. So I had been the editor-in-chief of BBC Online, as well as having been worked with Esther on That's Life. And so I knew how to structure things, and I knew how to make things work digitally. Yeah. And so I then started working a template out, and that took me quite a long time. And then I worked out other ways of doing it and what needs to be included. So it took me to launch from my mother's untimely death to actually launch the business took me 10 years. And it's now been running for 10 years. Or this will be the 10th year in October.
And when your mum died, what was it? What was it? What was the point, you know, that you kind of went, oh, my gosh, I didn't know all this stuff about.
I was looking after probate. And one of the things I discovered when going through the papers was my parents were married on Christmas Eve. And I had no idea about that. You know, we got ready for Christmas. They didn't particularly do anything themselves for Christmas Eve. So I had no idea until I was doing the probate that my mother and father married on Christmas Eve. Wow. So that was one of the many things that, you know, I kind of discovered, which I didn't know about her life. And I went actually, in the process of grieving, I went over to California to her best friend and talked about my mother's education and their friendship and her life before she became my mother, which of course was unknown to me actually, because I say we never talked about it. I think most people don't know about their parents' lives before they're their parents.
No. So what else was a revelation to you?
What about my mother?
Yeah.
The fact that, I mean, she wasn't particularly well educated formally, although she went on to become the editor of Home and Country, which was the Women's Institute magazine.
Wow.
How my parents met, I didn't know how they met. They met at a dance, according to Betty, my mother's best friend. My mother's very excited about that. So glad gradually. But the thing, what I don't have is her own, what she felt about life, what she felt about her experiences, yeah. Which is one of the things I include in autobiography, to make sure that, you know, you are able to tell your family and your future generations, you know, people in 200 years' time, it doesn't matter how people voted at the moment, but whatever you think about Brexit, write it down, because that's real history, your history. Otherwise, it'll be the politician and the journalist's version will be interpreted, and not your own family's version. So that's what. So I've learned quite a lot about her, but nowhere near as much as I wish I could know. And if she'd done an autobiography, I would be very happy, Bunny.
Yeah. So tell me how does the process work with autobiography? So what would people what do you do?
Well, what if it's an online system?
Yeah.
It also is. You can test it in 10 minutes. You can do a test if you want to, but it's an online system with a whole load of written by me that you can choose. Or if you're a good writer, you can just write it entirely in your own words. But it's a template that takes you through the stages of your life, asking questions about your parents, what they were like, as parents, about your education. For instance, when I went to school, my very first school, I wore a little gym slip and I had these large blue knickers with a pocket for a handkerchief. Right. You had to lift up your skirt in order to get your hanky. Now, can you imagine nowadays? It would be completely against every rule in the book. So, and I'm left-handed. When I was at school, I was forced to write with my right hand.
Right.
So this is, you know, people don't imagine that nowadays. So things have changed in the 69 years I've been alive. Lots of things have changed. Mm. How Christmases were celebrated. It was so much more simple when I was a kid. You know, and television. There were just two channels. There weren't all these millions of channels, and we had to wait for ages and ages to get a telephone. When we got it, one of those Bakelite ones, we shared it with our next door neighbours. It was a party line. So you had to wait for them to finish answering their phone or talking on the phone before you could make a call. Mm. When I was a kid, at the end of the road, there was a police box, you know, and that's what you went to go and make contact with the police if you didn't have a phone, or the policeman doing his rounds would go in to report back to the station. That's TARDIS. No child could have possibly imagined that people wouldn't have a transmitter, a mobile phone, all the rest of it. So we're, you know, all these things are little details which I help you take through in the system. And I say, if you're not a good writer, then you can select what I've written, or you can select it and edit it, or you can write it in your words. But step by step by step, it takes you through the story of your life. Not just the chronology, but also the flowers you love, the music you love, the films you love, your favorite recipes. Panning on family recipes is a really important thing. So there's all sorts of opportunities to talk about your feelings and your reactions to things, as well as actually what happened to you, what school was like.
Yeah. And so I presume this is available to people all over the world, is it?
Well, it's online, so it's an international service. At the moment, it's versioned particularly for the UK and for America and Canada. But obviously, at the moment, it's basically for the English-speaking world. But it will be versioned into different languages. And, of course, if you're using Google Chrome, then it'll do an automatic translation. And if you're not a good typist, there's a little microphone on the screen. You tap that, and then you can just dictate your words in, and it will. You'll have to edit it because it's not perfect. But it's actually pretty good, the Chrome dictation thing.
Yeah, fantastic. And how many people so far have used this service of yours?
Well, several hundred people have used it. And what's lovely is the people who do it, when they get their book, so they get their first book, they then order additional copies for their family. So there are thousands and thousands of the books out there, although only several hundred people have taken part in actually writing their own life story. So I'm very gratified that one lady, it was actually organised for up to 10 books, additional books. But one lady phoned up and she wanted 24, so I had to redo the software so she could order 24 books.
Yeah, amazing. And I mean, obviously, you're in the, you know, you've probably got a big personality network. Have you had some of your more famous people that you know take advantage of this service?
Well, it's actually, the interesting thing is it's really designed for everybody, not for celebrities. Because celebrities, their life stories are written and sold. Yeah. But of course, Dame Esther has done it because she has endorsed it. And so she had to do it to make sure it worked and she was happy with it because she, you know, she's a consumer journalist. She wouldn't recommend something that wasn't good. No. But actually, she's the only celebrity who's done it because, I say, to me, everybody's a celebrity to their family. To me, everybody's life is worth telling. So it's not really for celebrities. It's for you and me and everybody like us.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I think it's absolutely fascinating. And it was a real record.
You run the retirement cafe and you give advice to people who are moving from one stage of their life to another. Because when I stopped working full time for the BBC and then for the Eden Project, where I was a director of communications, you had a structure. You had meetings you had to go to. There were always things in the diary. And then when you suddenly stop working, there's this gap, there's this kind of hiatus until you then get extremely busy doing all the things, you know, the voluntary work and all the other things that you do. But in that hiatus, if you use that time to write your life story, there'll be a real heirloom for your family and a book of really fabulous, precious memories.
Yes. Well, I often say that, you know, I ask people, do you know who your grandparents are? And often people do. And I say, well, do you know who your great-grandparents are? And it's already gone. You know, those memories have already disappeared. And it's like, well, what did your grandfather do for a living, or grandmother? And they're like, oh, I'm not sure. And, you know, and you think, well, three generations, that it's lost, isn't it?
Well, that's so true. And actually, 70% of people in the UK don't know the name of a single great-grandparent. That's your parents' grandparents. You don't know one of their names. It's so sad. And you're quite right about how your grandfather or grandmother felt about their life. You know, it was a very different time. You know, the sort of work they did, how they lived. Well, one of the common things in the people who've done the book, particularly those who live in rural areas, is at Christmas, the family would all come round, and the cookers they had won't be big enough. So it was quite a common thing for a village to take their joint, usually beef in those days, not turkey, to the baker who'd finished making the Christmas loaves, put their joint in the morning, and then come back and collect it and take it home to your family, because they didn't have cookers that were big enough. So you know, these sorts of things, I don't think anybody does that nowadays at all.
No, absolutely not. But I do think... I think it's absolutely fascinating to be able to. It's providing a history lesson, but a very personal history lesson, isn't it? And you're picking up on your point about, you know, what was the emotional feeling about the decisions that they made, and about the politics of the day or the crisis du jour, you know, that what was their interpretation of what was going on?
It's actually a very visceral thing, this. Among the other inspiration for this, and my mother was the starting point, but the other one was, I have 14 letters written by my great-grandfather, Walter Mitchell. When he was 23, he went to America in 1867, just 2 years after the end of the Civil War, to seek his fortune. And those letters tell me he was brave, he was very loyal. Loyal in two contexts. Loyal because when he went, he thought he was going to get a grant to buy land from the American government. But the deal was you had to swear allegiance to the American Constitution. And he wrote back to his mum saying, I've already sworn allegiance to Queen Victoria and I can't break my promise to her, so I'm just going to have to earn the money. He went out with two friends, one of whom got typhus. And so my grandfather, who's a carpenter, used the money he'd earned to keep his friend going while he was being treated for typhus, for his bed and lodging and his medication. And his other friend got a job as a teacher, but didn't get paid for two terms. So Walter subbed him to keep him going. So what a loyal, what a love. So I feel so proud to have his genes rushing through my veins. But if I hadn't got those letters, I would know nothing about him. I know less about his son, my grandfather, than I know about Walter.
Amazing. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, if you don't, if we don't have these conversations with our elderly parents, we will also lost the knowledge that they've got of their parents and their grandparents.
Absolutely.
And so it needs to be done earlier rather than later, doesn't it?
If it's a conversation, record it. The whole point about this is, as you said earlier, you forget these things. Even if you have the conversations, you forget them. So even if you don't use autobiography, write down your life story. You can record it on your smartphone, write it down by hand, but however you do it, gather the stories, write either, my ideal with autobiography is for a grandparent and a grandchild to do it together, because then they share the time. The grandchild can ask sneaky questions like, were you any good at school? Or who did you first snog, grandma? And at the end of it, they will have a really, really beautiful book to share. But it'll give them the time and the experience, but it'll be recorded.
If you have the audio recordings as well, that's even another opportunity to be able to listen back to your grandmother or whatever.
Absolutely. And all video recording. We've all got these smartphones nowadays, with these little things. You can film somebody and you'll have the film. But if you do, the reason why, I was a film producer, I was not a television producer for years and years and years. The reason I don't produce a film is because who knows what format will exist in 50 years' time? Yeah. We've got MP4 at the moment. It used to be 1-inch tape. It used to be 2-inch tape. Changes all the time. So, but with a book, that will last for hundreds of years. So that's why, even though I love new technology, that's why I produce a book, because it will be there in 300 years' time. It's very high-quality paper I use.
And, of course, there's something very nice to be able to look at a book, and it's very tactile to kind of flick over through while you're having a cup of coffee at the kitchen table.
Absolutely. No, it really is. And as I say, the thing about the book also is, you can do it with the digital, but you could have lots of copies. So there's no argument about who gets Granny's recipe book or who has that particular precious photograph. You can produce it as many times as it's digital, so you can produce the book as many times as you like, and so everybody can have their own copy.
Fantastic. So it's been fascinating talking to you. What's the future for autobiography? Where do you see it going next?
Well, certainly produce more versions of other areas around the world. I'm at the moment working on a junior version, which will be a much smaller version for parents to do for special birthdays for children 10, 12, 15 years old, so that they can do that over a weekend. But I'm concentrating on autobiography at the moment, just to get as many people to do it as possible, because I just believe it's such a precious thing to do. So expanding the numbers. So spread the word, people, spread the word. And take the 10-minute test, because if you have a free trial, in 10 minutes, if you've got two digitized photographs of yourself, answer the first few questions, it will produce the first 6 pages of your book, so you can see what it would look like.
Lovely. Well, I think it's a great idea, and I think, I think everyone should do it. We will have a go ourselves, I'm sure.
Right.
Thank you for your time this morning. I really enjoyed having a chat with you, and your obvious enthusiasm for your this project, and yeah, you're delivering something great into the world. So well done you.
Thank you very much, Neil. Thank you for the opportunity. It's lovely to talk to you.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed my conversation with Bryher. If you did, then please leave a review on iTunes to help more people like you to discover us. It really does help. On that note, thank you to Durga and James Mackay, who recently left reviews and shared their thoughts on recent episodes. I appreciate your time and efforts. If you'd like to find out more about autodotbiography and the work they are doing, you can check out the show notes on our website at retirementcafe.co.uk, where you'll find some useful links. And if you've not yet subscribed, then you can do so on our website, retirementcafe.co.uk, or on your preferred podcast player. So until next time, this is Justin King helping you feel more informed in your retirement.
Thank you for listening to the Retirement Cafe podcast with Justin King. To find out more, you can find us online at theretirementcafe.co.uk.